Hello, my name is Joris Dick. I'm from Delft University of Technology, and I'm inviting you to take a look with me at the light and the dark in The Girl with the Pearl Earring. Why is this painting such an icon of 17th century Dutch painting? And what is it that attracts so many visitors to see this painting in the Mauritshuis House? The striking suggestion of this painting is that the girl has suddenly turned from the dark into the light and makes eye contact with the viewer, briefly, spontaneously, or perhaps even accidentally. The dramatic contrast in lighting between the girl and the background helps to make that suggestion both compelling and appealing. But how did Vermeer create this stark contrast between dark and light? What materials did he use? What techniques did he apply? Together with Abby, we address these questions in the examination of the girl in the spotlight. Here, you see a so-called paint cross-section, prepared from a minute paint sample taken from the background. On the light ground of the canvas, Vermeer painted a thin black layer consisting of charcoal. On top of this black layer, Vermeer applied a translucent green glaze made up of blue and yellow colorants. That transparent glaze layer adds a greenish tonality to the background, but more importantly, it increases the absorption of light and therefore enhances the dark. In this microscopic cross-section, the black layer appears to be flat and thin, but our examination of the entire painting showed otherwise. Using different penetrative imaging techniques, macro XRF scanning and optical coherence tomography, we were able to chart the topography of the charcoal layer buried under the green glaze layer. And when zooming into one of these images, we recognize the brushstrokes and clearly see the coarse way in which the charcoal layer was applied. Here, we see the same region of the painting, but now we're imaging the utmost surface topography. Note how all the hidden brushstrokes are effectively covered and how the surface topography is dominated by paint cracks and occasional canvas structure showing through the paint layers. While the surface of the background is almost uniformly flat, only the white collar of the girl is painted with impasto, that is to say, the white paint is elevated from the surrounding area, producing a distinct and sharp contour line around the collar, which also happens to be the brightest part of the painting. In summary, the background glaze layer adds green tonality, it enhances the overall darkness of the background, and it very effectively covers up the underlying brushwork. All these features, as we will now see, stand in sharp contrast with the paint characteristics of the girl itself. Using one of the newest imaging techniques, macro X-ray powder diffraction, our Antwerp colleagues were able to plot with high analytical accuracy, the distribution of crystalline materials in the girl's face. The results showed the use of common pigments in the girl's head, including vermilion red in the flesh tones and lapis lazuli in her blue headdress. But it also brought to light Vermeer's use of two distinct types of the pigment lead white, made up of varying ratios of sericite and hydrosericite. These are the main crystalline components of 17th century lead white. Lead white rich in hydrosericite was found exclusively in the bright tones of the face, indicated here in red. However, the girl's shadow and the background, indicated in green, contained lead white with significantly lower concentrations of hydrosericite. These findings were later on confirmed by analysis of paint samples taken from a light and a darker part of the girl's head. Analysis at the German synchrotron facility DAISY in Hamburg showed that all layers of the light sample contained twice the concentration of hydrosericite compared to the paint layers used in a dark paint sample. But what is the painterly significance of these chemical findings? We know that lead white rich in hydrosericite has a different optical behavior. It is more opaque, more reflective, and therefore produces a brighter white compared to the type containing lower concentrations of hydrosericite, which is more translucent and less bright. Obviously, Vermeer must have recognized these differences and made good use of them. When standing in front of the painting, and when taking a close look at the various skin tones, one can almost sense the translucency of the shadows and the strong reflection of the light parts. To summarize again, the girl's background is translucent, it is dark, greenish, and free of brushwork, whereas the light parts of the girl are made up of an opaque, reflective white containing some impasto in the brightest area, the girl's color. I hope to have shown you that Vermeer deliberately uses and exploits the optical properties of pigments and paint layer buildup to maximize the contrast between the light figure and the dark background. What could have possibly inspired Vermeer to explore this strong contrast between dark and light and make use of it, very successfully in painterly terms, in the girl with the pearl earring? Let me conclude with our hypothesis, which, like every good hypothesis, is a bit speculative.
Wow.
Ja.
Is er gewoon.
Ja, is er, ja.
Bestond ze nog?
Ja, precies.
Wauw, die is wel te gek dit hoor.
Die is wel te gek. Je moet eigenlijk echt even kijken. Kijk.
Wow.
Ja, het is te gek hè.
Ja, dat is heel nieuw.
Ja, het is, ja, maar de scherpte diepte is mooi. Hè?
A few years ago, I participated in a Dutch TV program called Het Geheim van de Meester. While recreating Vermeer's girl, we experimented with a so-called camera obscura. This is a projection camera based on 17th century lens technology, which we know has influenced Vermeer's work as a painter. We placed a model dressed up as the girl in front of our camera. The projection screen of the camera obscura has a much more limited sensitivity for brightness variation than the human eye. And that is why the girl appeared in bright colors on the screen, but she was set against a largely undifferentiated black background. That aspect is similar to the real painting. I'm not claiming that Vermeer must have had such a camera in his studio, let alone that I'm suggesting that Vermeer must have seen an identical projection image, but we do wonder whether the low sensitivity of a projection screen in a camera obscura might have inspired Vermeer to use an equally strong contrast in the girl with the pearl earring. If you'd like to know more, please read our recent papers on this topic. Let me thank the people and institutions mentioned below, and thank you for watching this video.